That's a very big fluffy bun.
Where's the beef?
Some hamburger places give you a lot less beef on a lot of bun.
Where's the beef?
At Wendy's, we serve a hamburger we modestly call a single. And Wendy's single has more beef than the Whopper or Big Mac. At Wendy's, you get more beef and less bun.
Hey, where's the beef? I don't think there's anybody back there.
You want something better. You're Wendy's kind of people.
The wheel's spinning again, 6:30 weeknights.
And now stories of the strange, the bizarre, the unexpected. Jack Palance and Holly Palance in Ripley's Believe It or Not. We now take you to Believe It or Not and Japan.
Park, in which acres of giant, semi-abstract sculptures are on permanent display. Brightly painted shapes and forms tell of ancient Asian myths. One man realized a lifelong dream when he built this elaborate fantasy world. It's called the Tiger Balm Garden, and it's the creation of a wealthy eccentric, Ah Boon Ha. Before the turn of the century, while he was still a child, Ah Boon Ha wanted to play in a public park in his native Rangoon. But the park was closed to him. It could only be used by Europeans, not Asians. He never forgot the incident. Ah Boon Ha grew up to invent a liniment called Tiger Balm. It's still used today, not only in the Orient, but throughout the world by people who believe it's good for almost anything that ails you. Ah Boon Ha became a millionaire several times over. And then, in 1935, he built a park that anyone could enter whenever they wanted to. In fact, he built two of them. One is in Singapore, and this is the other. Rambling over 8 acres of very valuable Hong Kong real estate. For Ah Boon Ha, the cost was incidental. Like so many people, he simply had a desire to do something different, the common cause for many of the world's more unusual achievements. Long before it became part of an annual contest in Spivey's Corner, North Carolina, hollering was a customary form of communication between local farmers. A neighbor often greets a friend with a good morning holler across the tobacco fields. If he sees or hears a rattlesnake, he most likely will send out a warning holler. Another practical use of haulers is to call in the livestock. Some haulers may seem obscure to all but the caller himself. This year's winner, in fact, claimed his hauler didn't mean anything, but it did get everyone's attention. Shouting, however, is only one way to get attention. In Prague, Czechoslovakia, individual athletes unite in a massive display of physical precision. Almost 200,000 participants of all ages perform in one of the world's most spectacular gymnastic events, staged in the world's largest stadium. Participate in this colorful 4-day event is an honor. The athletes were selected from nearly a million volunteers. Thousands thousands of athletes from throughout the country perform in perfect harmony, although they've had only 3 days together to rehearse the complex movements. This exhibition of gymnastic precision takes place only once in every 5 years. More unusual events, however, are commonplace among yogi practitioners in India. Here a yogi executes Vastra Doti, the cleansing of the stomach. With a method perfected only after years of practice, he is able to swallow nearly 15 feet of sterilized gauze, an act that would choke most people. A long fast is mandatory before undertaking the potentially dangerous exercise. Then, by controlling his breath and other reflexes, he is able to fill his stomach with the gauze. By rhythmic movement of his abdomen, he rubs his stomach clean with the material. Then, very carefully, he removes the cloth. Even in India, the practice of stomach cleansing is not commonplace. It is as unique in its way as the artistic creations that once were a landmark in the Mojave Desert of California. For a number of years, a display of strange, fantastic figures caused tourists to stop, look, and be delighted. The place was named Possum Trot by its owners, Calvin and Ruby Black. Calvin had been a woodcarver for carnivals much of his life, but not until he settled here did he fulfill his real ambition: to surround himself with a world of meticulously crafted, lifelike dolls, all female. He engineered many of them to be animated by the wind. For 50 cents, a tourist could visit his birdcage theater to look, not to buy. None of his 70 redwood and pine creations were for sale. Calvin died in 1972, his wife not long after. The wood carvings of Possum Trot were then bought by a dealer who regarded them as genuine works of folk art. Today, the dolls are worth about $12,000 each. They are one of a kind and can never be duplicated. In Japan, the desire to copy a unique object has long been the preoccupation of Yutaro Mikami. A successful construction company executive, Mr. Mikami recently realized a daring, outrageous dream. It's known as the White House of Osaka, a two-thirds scale replica of the original one in Washington, D.C. The facade of the Mikami Company headquarters is an amazing duplication of the presidential mansion. Inside, however, the resemblance to the White House is less authentic. This staircase, for example, is Mr. Mikami's version of the one in Gone with the Wind. Admittedly infatuated with things American, Mr. Mikami takes great pride in giving guests and customers a grand tour of his new, but still incomplete showplace. Work still continues in the Oval Office, especially on the centerpiece desk, to be an accurate copy of the one in Washington. When finished, Mr. Mikami will move in, and it will become the office of the president. Inspired as a teenager by American movies, in which dreams usually come true, Mr. Mikami has made it all the way to the White House. The second White House in Osaka, Japan. Believe it or not. In India, a holy man attracts pilgrims who come to the Ganges River by burying his head in the sand. Believe it or not. In a moment, unearth a body in Korea to honor the bones of the dead. Explore the compulsion that drives wildebeest to panic. Discover why the crowded graveyards of Tokyo are in such great demand. Go aboard a gigantic submersible city. Stand aside as millions of crabs invade a small town. Struggle across the mountains with a nomadic tribe.
Announcing Sears Automotive and Hardware Sale. Save 10 to 35% on selected tires. Weather handlers, steel belted radials as low as $4 for $99. Save over 50% on these oil filters, just 99 cents. This Craftsman 99-piece tool set, now $88. This Craftsman circular saw or router, both half price, now $49.99. Hurry in for hundreds of savings now.
There's more for your life at Sears.
I wanted you to be the first to know.
Wait a minute. You proposed, she accepted. Yeah. That makes me the third to know.
I stand corrected.
To my little brother. To his first and hopefully last marriage, and to myself
for remaining the eligible bachelor. Don't toast a marriage with one calorie.
Diet Pepsi, you do. Taste it. They put NutraSweet in it.
Mmm. Yeah. You know, I hope Mom likes her.
Well, if she doesn't, you'll be the first to know.
Taste improved by Diet Pepsi.
Add the flavor of tangy cheddar cheese to a thicker cut potato chip, and you get O'Grady's brand au gratin potato chips with a heartier cheese taste and a deeper cut that cradles lots of tangy cheddar flavor. So for the hearty taste of more cheese and more potato, taste O'Grady's au gratin. The more cheese, more potato potato chip.
Tomorrow.
I love you.
I love you.
Yeah, even though you are my sister.
Celebrate the holiday together with your family.
I underestimated you.
And experience the feeling of Call to Glory. Then, the wait is over. It's the season premiere of NFL Monday Night Football as the Los Angeles Rams take on the new Dallas Cowboys. And another season of Monday Night Madness begins.
Tomorrow, all starting at 8, 7 Central.
Trees are covered with swarms of living leaves. Millions of monarch butterflies. Every autumn, they arrive from afar to cluster together and then carry on their miraculous life cycle throughout the winter.
The migration of the monarch is one of those remarkable facts of nature that seem impossible. Each butterfly has a wingspan of about 2 inches. Yet it can, and does, fly over 2,000 miles in a non-stop instinctive journey all the way from Canada to where we are now, Santa Cruz, California. Several generations of monarchs will be born here by springtime. Then, amazingly, the fragile butterflies will return to Canada, sometimes flying at speeds of 30 miles an hour. The departure date will be dictated by some mysterious biological compulsion, a compulsion shared by many creatures on Earth. The life of the wildebeest is one of continuous migration, a constant quest for fresh grazing lands. The large herd has depleted this plain in Kenya, so it must move on, even though it faces a formidable obstacle. The wildebeest must forge the raging deep waters of the Mara River if they are to survive. They're poor swimmers, but they're driven on by an irresistible collective urge. The advance guard finds easy passage, but as more and more climb the steep bank, the slope turns to a mass of slippery mud. Soon, the steady flow from water to land turns to chaos. Hundreds of animals scramble to find new routes to safety. The panic-stricken wildebeest begin to fight among themselves. Many are trampled underfoot. Others drown during the crossing. Despite this carnage, the wildebeest population has expanded over the years from about 200,000 in the 1960s to a present count of more than 2 million. For the moment, the herd is at rest. Yet the migration is not over. Their movement will continue, dictated by hunger. A more mysterious force, however, is at work here on Christmas Island in the Indian Ocean. Adult red crabs with bodies about 4 inches in diameter will take 2 weeks to wend their way to an area predetermined for the mating and spawning process. This rocky, wave-lashed piece of coastline is the unlikely focal point for the propagation of the species. The female deposits her eggs into the water at night, and almost immediately, they are hatched. Millions of baby crabs the size of peas must now make their way back to the rainforest, led by adult males. The most direct route is through the main town of Christmas Island. The 3,000 residents of Flying Fish Cove simply close up their doors and windows until the passing parade goes by. For them, the red tide is only a momentary nuisance. If deprived of water for too long, the crabs will die. Their goal is to reach the life-giving moisture of the rainforest. Not all of them will make it. The continuation of the species will be assured, however, if only 1 in 1,000 survives. In nature, such struggles for survival are guided by instinct. In the high plains of Khuzestan, the nomadic Bakhtiari people are driven by the hard-won knowledge that they must move on or die. Each spring, when the grass in local pastures is exhausted, the tribes gather up their flocks to begin a remarkable journey. For the people to survive, the sheep must survive. And in the summer, the only grass is 250 treacherous miles away, across 6 mountain ranges. To guide them, they rely on the experience of a chieftain who for 30 years has led the way. In over 2 centuries, however, no one has yet found an easy way to cross ancient Persia's rugged Zagros mountain range while herding over 1 million sheep. Men, women, and children make the journey. For them, it's part of a natural rhythm, as easily accepted as the constant threat of accidental death. The paths are familiar, but perilous. To the Bakhtiari, the long walk over the mountains is an annual ordeal, a price they willingly pay to maintain the freedom of their way of life. In these mountains, the Bakhtiari are subject only to the weather. Waiting out the rain is not a welcome break. The pack animals carry only enough food for 60 days. Any delay becomes critical. What mountain torrents destroy, the Bakhtiari hurriedly repair. To rebuild a vital section of trail takes precious days. Once a new path is made, they continue their race to reach new pastures before their food runs out. Sheep is a constant priority. The water is near freezing, yet the Bakhtiari wade in to create a human lifeline for the animals. The combined effect of exertion and thin mountain air causes one of the men to collapse. For a moment, the sheep are forgotten, and then suddenly remembered. By safely crossing the river, the Bakhtiari have reached a resting place. For a few days, they will recuperate in camp, gathering their strength for the assault on the final 15,000-foot-high barrier. At this altitude, they must get across the summit during daylight hours. Neither they nor their livestock could survive a night in the high winds and freezing temperatures. Its end. A half a million people have not only endured, they have prevailed. For the Bakhtiari, it was just a walk over the mountain. In 5 months, they must make the return trip. And next year, do it all over again. Believe it or not.
Navigate over long distances, homing pigeons have a built-in compass, magnetic material embedded in nerve tissue. Believe it or not. In a moment, dig up a body to honor the bones in an ancient Korean ritual. Visit a house of worship made entirely of mud. Learn how the Japanese decide who gets buried in crowded Tokyo graveyards. Watch as an instant home is built in a single day.
Don't just fit, they fit every place we go.
And everything we do. I mean everything.
And they do it comfortably.
Yeah, I see what you mean. Wrangler clothes look as great as they feel.
And the look is definitely, positively Wrangler.
It's
Harper seems to have it all.
Sweetheart.
A loving daughter, a devoted wife, and a son who wants too much.
If Grant found out, he'd have a coronary.
We all gotta go sometime.
Lloyd Bridges is with you, running the family that rules the empire of paper dolls this fall.
Ripley's Believe It or Not will continue in a moment.
She's a police psychiatrist. Her specialty is criminal behavior. To her, being a cop means more than just solving crime. Tuesdays this fall, Lindsay Wagner is with you as Jesse.
Speed calling from Illinois Bell makes getting in touch a lot easier for everyone.
Dad, have you seen my... never mind.
All you have to do is dial one or two numbers, and your calls will go through instantly.
Marge, I need an emergency manicure.
It saves time when time is critical.
Mom, what do you know about washing machines?
Speed calling is so convenient, you can even use it to call long distance. Keeping in touch is a touch easier with speed calling from Illinois Bell.
I tell you, playing polo is a lot tougher than it looks.
Sure is.
And even though the horses do the running, you still can work up a thirst.
So after a chucker or two, we have Questerons drink light beer from Miller.
Yeah, light tastes great, and it's got a third less calories than a regular beer.
And it's less filling.
And that's important, because tomorrow we're going to try our hand at water polo.
Yeah, I sure hope those horses can swim.
Me too.
Light beer from Miller. Everything you always wanted in a beer. And less.
Jeopardy's coming September 10th.
A tomb. The final resting place. Usually. But such was not the case for the famous Cardinal Richelieu. He was buried here in the Sorbonne College in Paris almost 300 years ago, and his remains lay undisturbed for over a century and a half. But then came that spectacular upheaval known as the French Revolution. The King and Queen of France lost their heads to the bloody blade of the guillotine, as did thousands of others. But living victims, it seems, weren't quite enough to slake popular thirst for violence. The mob broke in here, ripped open the cardinal's tomb, and tore from it the cardinal's body, which was quite well preserved. "Give us the head," roared the mob, and that's just what happened. The cardinal's head was chopped from his body and thrown to the crowd. They laughed and tossed it about, and finally threw it out into the street, to the delight of a group of children playing there. They proceeded to use the cardinal's head as a football, kicking, passing it through the streets of Paris until it split in two. Some 70 years passed before the two halves were finally recovered and returned here. Unfortunately, there was no body to attach it to. Most of that had been dismembered by the mob, scattered, and irretrievably lost, except for one finger, the ring finger. It and the cardinal's head are about all that share this magnificent tomb now. But then, the most peculiar things sometimes happen to people once they are dead. Temporary tombs made of straw may seem an unusual way to honor the dead. In Korea, however, such structures permit the kin of the deceased to perform a double burial ceremony, one for the body and then, 3 years later, another ritual for the reclaimed bones. It is an ancient rite called Chobu. The bones of the dead are carefully resurrected from a grave built above ground. The faithful believe that once free of earthly flesh, the deceased may more easily complete the journey to heaven. To strip away any remaining flesh, the bones undergo a series of ritual cleansings by the immediate family. Once the gravesite is thoroughly searched and every bone recovered and cleaned, they are reassembled to create a complete skeleton. The extended three-year period of grief ends as the carefully wrapped skeleton is prepared for its final journey. The funeral procession is far from somber. Bedecked with flowers, the bones are transported to the narrow grave where they will remain to be disturbed no more. Such double burials are rare in Korea now, practiced only in a few remote locations. For the faithful, however, the tradition assures the rise of the spirit to heaven as surely as smoke seeks the sky. In Japan, one problem with dying is finding a place to be buried. As cities become more crowded, the traditional Japanese respect for their ancestors, as demonstrated here during the annual Festival of Souls, has created a new problem. There is simply not enough available space in Tokyo's public cemeteries for all those who want to be buried there. And there is no room left to create more cemeteries. Every possible location is already in use. To allocate what space there is, the government conducts an annual lottery. The luck of the draw determines who, among more than 10,000 applicants, will be allowed to purchase the available burial plots. Only slightly more than 1,000 are for sale each year. The demand is created by the desire of older people to be buried near their living relatives in Tokyo. Otherwise, the elderly fear their graves will not be visited frequently. For every winner, there are 9 losers. All, however, are more than willing to pay $600 for a plot close to home. For the aged, the problem is to survive, to try again next year. In New Orleans, a concern for the well-being of the deceased is on elaborate display at the Metairie Cemetery. Because of the generally swampy soil around the city, above-ground tombs have become a traditional way to pay last respects. It was not respect, however, that motivated the gentleman credited with the creation of this ornate burying ground. All this land was once the site of a famous racetrack and an exclusive jockey club. Back in the 1870s, one Charles T. Howard applied for membership and was refused. Or so the story goes. He had the money, but according to whispered gossip, he wasn't a member of the proper political party. He swore revenge. Someday, he said, I'll buy your damned racetrack and turn it into a cemetery. Eventually, it was Howard who helped form the syndicate that did exactly that. They bought the racetrack and the exclusive jockey club and transformed it all into this cemetery. And that is how Charles T. Howard finally gained permanent membership in Metairie. Believe it or not. In Mexico, skulls made of hard candy bearing the initials of the deceased are kept as sentimental souvenirs. Believe it or not. In a moment, go inside ancient caves transformed into modern apartments. Discover the beauty of a basic building material, mud. Find out how gigantic floating cities may solve Japan's housing shortage.
I've been told that men don't make passes at girls who wear glasses. But the question is, do girls who wear glasses make passes at men? When they're feeling pretty, they do. That's where Silkient shampoo and conditioner come in. My hair's funny, dry on Monday, limp on Tuesday. Well, Silkian suggests to make my hair beautiful every day of the week. I don't know how it works, but it's never missed yet. Silkians, because you're always in the mood to feel beautiful.
It's so smooth it won't skip or drag. It won't even scratch this delicate surface. This is the new Papermate AccuPoint roller pen. The AccuPoint has a stainless steel point and metal rolling ball for remarkably smooth fine point writing. Now if that sounds impressive, wait till you see what it can do on a far more demanding surface, like paper. The new Papermate AccuPoint. And now the pencil that's always sharp, the new Papermate SharpWriter pencil.
Wishbone. Wishbone. Your salad wants the freshness of two new Southern recipe dressings from Wishbone. For freshness, salads wish for Wishbone.
Now you can rip into delicious Sunkissed fruit rolls. Sunkissed fruit rolls. Have you heard your fruit today?
Do you want
sodas? On Call to Glory.
They wouldn't serve us.
I joined the Air Force because I didn't want to go through this. I didn't want my kids to go through this.
This is not Birmingham, Alabama. This is Edwards Air Force Base in California.
Tomorrow and every Monday at 8, 7 Central, Call to Glory.
Was built near Natchez, Mississippi. A young lady, Miss Julia Augusta Williams, used to play on these tree-shaded slopes. Miss Julia married a wealthy gentleman named Dr. Haller Nutt. Dr. Nutt bought the property as a surprise for her, and together, in 1858, they set out to build their dream house. An eight-sided, six-story high mansion, the likes of which had never been seen before in Mississippi. Construction began before the Civil War. Dr. Nutt was a planter, scientist, and a medical doctor whose father had made a fortune in the cotton business. He and Miss Julia hired the best architect, the famous Samuel Sloan of Philadelphia, to draw up the plans and provide the northern craftsmen to transform the drawings into reality. But a distant shot fired at Fort Sumter, South Carolina, put an end to Dr. Nutt's dream. The northern workmen left their tools where they lay, and what could have become a showplace became an unfinished masterpiece. Construction was never resumed. Dr. Nutt's fortune was lost during the Civil War, and he died before the hostilities ended. His legacy, however, the incomplete but unique Longwood Mansion, has been designated a National Historic Monument. Dwellings are often an expression of a cultural tradition. Architectural style and structural techniques, however, are often shaped by the building materials most available to the people of the area. In the bustling city of Jenny, Mali, in West Africa, there are very few buildings made with wood, steel, or concrete. Virtually all are constructed with that most basic of natural resources, mud. Believe it or not, nearly one quarter of the Earth's population lives beneath roofs and within walls made of sun-dried mud. Before recorded history, desert peoples built with mud in ways that were practical, dependable, and could please the eye. Sand, clay, water, and straw are all that's required to produce the bricks to be baked solid by the sun. Called al-tub in Arabic, later to be known as adobe in Spanish, this foundation of desert dwellings cost virtually nothing here, is in endless supply, and is easy to build with. For the architect, its versatility allows a wide range of imaginative forms and designs. Mud structures may seem to have serious limitations. This magnificent mosque proves otherwise. It is as large as the Parthenon in Greece and has been the center of worship for nearly a century. Wooden struts support the towers and provide access to repair damage done by the elements. The Mosque of Djenne is as much a monument to faith as it is to one of nature's most abundant building materials, the earth itself. In the Loire Valley in France, nature once provided ready-made homes for the cave-dwelling Neanderthal man. Apparently, not too much has changed in 50,000 years. Here, near the city of Chinon, people of all ages have left conventional apartments or houses to live as modern cave dwellers. The hills of the Loire River abound in natural caverns of soft but compact rock. Additional space can easily be hollowed out to suit individual needs. Simplicity or luxury is a matter of personal choice. The caves can accommodate almost any lifestyle. Cool in the summer and well insulated by the earth in winter, caves nevertheless still get damp during the rainy season. But the price is right, and thousands of Frenchmen have returned to their ancient ancestral homes, bringing with them a few modern conveniences. Housekeeping in caves is becoming ever more popular, while in Japan, owning a man-made home is still the traditional priority. Building a dream home, however, takes money and time. But now technology has made it possible for owners of a building lot, such as this family in Nagoya, to get a brand new home cheaply and quickly. Made on an assembly line, it will be a sturdy, ceramic, modular home. Windows, doors, wiring, several hundred thousand items are all installed and checked before the house leaves the factory. The modules are then trucked to the site, six workmen bolt them together, and the entire job is completed in a single day. Some 20,000 of these instant homes were put up last year. Space for new homes, however, is disappearing fast, and the Japanese have set out to meet the challenge. Looking to the future, they commissioned the building of this giant marine structure called Aquapolis. The first full-scale model of a floating city, it's intended as one solution to the world's growing housing and energy problems. Attached to the island of Okinawa for an industrial fair, its baseball field-sized deck above and spacious halls below have attracted millions of visitors, anxious to see what community living on the ocean might be like. In many ways, it resembles a conventional apartment building. The 9-story high Aquapolis is maintained by advanced computer technology. In the event of bad weather or heavy waves, the entire city can be submerged to minimize movement. 14 typhoons struck the area in a 6-month period, but normal operations were barely affected. Equipped with its own power and water, Aquapolis is as self-sufficient as any land city. Its designers believe that it's a practical way to provide living space for a growing population. They envision a future in which homes, offices, theaters, even factories can be included in floating cities. A future in which a new way of life may begin on the oceans of the world. Believe it or not.
In a moment, learn the simple but astounding secret of an amazing balancing act.
Let's taste!
Thousands wanted a diet soft drink that's refreshing but not too sweet. Here's new Tab.
Let's taste!
We're putting diet soft drinks to the test. Why taste the same as all the rest? Now here's your invitation to try a crisp, refreshing new Tab.
Let's taste! New Tab!
Just a sec.
Hey, fish, you're jumping, buddy.
There's room for your life.
Just ran in to get what I need, but then I bumped into Harris Tweed.
There's more for your life at Sears.
I heard sound from a laser disc. What a surprise. And Converse Pro Stars, just my size. I could spend hours here. All the guys.
There's more for your life.
Where you been?
Shopping.
At Sears.
What?
When you play telephone, if you can't hear everything, that's part of the game. But when you pay for calls, it's no fun. AT&T thinks that every long-distance call should sound as close as next door, and isn't that why you call?
Want to try it, too?
Calling anywhere, anytime, long-distance operators over a century of commitment. That's AT&T. The more you hear, the better we sound.
Reach out and touch someone.
Out here, I'm the boss. But a few years ago, I felt foreign countries were telling me how much fuel I could have. Now I hear Phillips has geared up two super refineries for oil it's tough to work with. Stuff America has lots of, but refineries wouldn't mess with before. I can use any fuel, but I buy Phillips. They're helping us use American oil and be our own boss.
Fine products for you and your car from Phillips Petroleum, the performance company.
He's a private investigator of sorts, but he only handles one kind of case, losses of the heart.
You know, I've never met anybody like you. Why do you put yourself through this, Maxwell?
What secret compels him to spend his life reuniting lost loves?
Don't you think it's time you let go?
Deborah Dare and Tony Franciosa with you. Saturday, September 22nd, for the special 90-minute premiere of Finder of Lost Loves.
Back when I was a boy, growing up in Pennsylvania, simple objects like these were not only a way to get a job done, but were also a way to create our own entertainment. That was back in the Stone Ages, before television. 11 nails, a block of wood, and a hammer. And that would have been enough to keep anybody entertained for at least an hour. And most people puzzled for longer than that, if they were challenged to balance 10 of these nails on the head of just one of them. Impossible? Not if you know the secret.
Now be careful. Don't pinch yourself.
A straight, forward approach simply won't work. One is easy. 10. Is impossible unless you do it like this. One to start with. Then 8. Laid down on that one. With their heads alternating. That makes 9. Then, number 10. Laid head to tail with the one on the bottom. Squeeze the top and the bottom together. The rest is easy. You put the entire collection on the head of the one driven into the block of wood. It's as easy as pinning a tail on a donkey. Believe it.